Okay, friends, welcome back. Whoa, where did everything go? There we are. So today we're going to finish up on our discussion of the relationship between sequence and structure and function with an example of a system that's really, really well understood. And there are a lot more proteins that are more complicated than this, but this is one area where with a little bit of instruction, you can design a sequence and it will likely fold in the way that we're going to talk about. So I showed you this peptide sequence last time, I think at the very end. And one of the things I don't think I pointed out to you yet, we identified the nonpolar amino acids, methionine, leucine, valine, another leucine, couple other leucines, valine, leucine, couple there. And one of the things that we didn't quite get to is I was going to tell you that there is a pattern of how often the nonpolar amino acids show up in this sequence. It's difficult to see if you don't know about it, but once you've seen it, it's difficult to unsee, and it's quite easy to find. So notice that as we start here with this nonpolar amino acid, I count 1, 2, 3, and then here's a nonpolar residue 4, okay? And then I count 1, 2, 3, hold on, sorry. Which one am I counting right? 1, 2, and then 3 is a nonpolar residue, then 1, 2, 3, 4. So there's a space of 3 and then 4 in between nonpolar residues. Again, 1, 2, 3, there's a space of 3 here. This one shows up a little bit in a strange spot, but if we count 1, 2, 3, 4, there's not a polar residue, but if we count 1, 2, 3, there's another, and 1, 2, 3, 4, there's another, 1, 2, 3, there's another, 1, 2, 3, 4, there's another. And so there's this sort of spacing of every 3 and then every 4 amino acids we see a nonpolar residue. And the pattern's not perfect, but it doesn't have to be. And actually the pattern's easier to see if we use letters. We'll label the first amino acid that's nonpolar with the letter A, B, C, D. There's the second nonpolar amino acid. And then if we continue on E, F, and G, then we get back to A, and there's a nonpolar amino acid, and then A, B, C, D, E, F, G, another nonpolar at D. And so we can continue. There's sort of this increment of sequence that is 7 amino acids long, and the A and the D positions tend to be nonpolar, not always, but in general tend to be nonpolar, whereas the other positions tend to be polar. And this regular pattern of nonpolar residues, every 3 and then every 4 amino acids, this sort of 7 amino acid repeating unit is called a heptad. And sometimes people call this kind of sequence a heptad repeat because of the placement of these nonpolar amino acids. So some people have asked before, how do you know where to start counting with these nonpolar residues? Basically, you find a few nonpolar amino acids in a sequence. You start with one and try out A and see if a nonpolar amino acid shows up at D. And then you keep going and see if the pattern fits. If it doesn't, then try starting with D at the first nonpolar amino acid and then go E, F, G, A and see if that works. Now, we've talked about nonpolar amino acids before. Here is the structure of leucine, here is valine, here is methionine. And I think you learned in 351 about the hydrophobic effect, about why oil and water don't mix. Is that vaguely familiar, or are you at least used to the idea that oil and water don't mix? The reason for this is because When nonpolar functional groups are exposed to water, the water in the immediate vicinity of the nonpolar functional group has to slow down. Basically, the nonpolar group is taking up space near water molecules that would normally have been other water molecules, and so these water molecules in the immediate vicinity of the nonpolar side chain don't have as many hydrogen bonding partners, so they slow down to make their hydrogen bond stronger with the remaining partners they have, and you end up with this pseudo ice-like layer encrusting each of these nonpolar side chains, and the water around those side chains has really low entropy, and that's unfavorable because if a process decreases entropy, that should tend to have an unfavorable effect on free energy. And so there's a driving force for the protein or peptide to change its shape such that the nonpolar functional groups are no longer exposed to water, but are rather in the interior of a protein. And that liberates the water molecules that used to be surrounding the nonpolar functional groups, and they have way more conformational and translational entropy. They can move around quite a bit. Increasing entropy has a favorable effect on free energy, and that's, in many cases, the main driving force for protein folding, and this is called the hydrophobic effect. So the question we need to ask now is, how will this sequence arrange itself in a way that causes the A and D positions to not be exposed to solvent? And the first option we're going to look at is the alpha helix. So here is an image of the backbone of an alpha helix. And one of the things that defines the alpha helix is, of course, are the phi and psi dihedral angles. If we measured phi and psi for these amino acids, we would see that they are all in the vicinity of minus 57 and minus 47. And when you have a chain of these, when you have a string of amino acids with these dihedral angles, the chain wraps around itself and you get this helical pattern. But one of the characteristic things about an alpha helix is the carbonyl oxygen of the I position, and then we count onward, I plus 1, I plus 2, oops. I plus 3, and then I plus 4. The carbonyl oxygen of the I position residue is hydrogen bound to the amide proton of the I plus 4 amino acid. And I'm not drawing that particularly well. Maybe I should try again. The reason protons are not shown here is actually you can't see protons in crystal structures of proteins. So this is a hydrogen bond between the I plus 4 nitrogen and the I position carbonyl oxygen. And this pattern of I to I plus 4 hydrogen bonding is characteristic of the alpha helix, but what that tells you is if you go through one turn of the helix, you're basically somewhere between 3 and 4 amino acids away. And if you average this out over many amino acids of a helix, what you find is there are about 3.6 amino acids per turn in a canonical alpha helix with these dihedral angles. And that number is important because 3.6 is basically halfway through a 7 amino acid sequence. Okay? And if we were to tighten that up just a little bit, tighten up the rotation a little bit to 3.5 amino acids per turn, then you could accommodate a full A, B, C, D, E, F, G heptad in two turns of a helix. Okay, so, and what that would tend to do, it would be you get through A, B, C, D, E, F, G, you've gone two turns of the helix, and now you're back to an A position. two turns of the helix back to an A position, two turns of the helix back to an A position. This would tend to align all of the A position residues along the same face of the helix. And because the D positions are, you know, four amino acids away from the A positions, they're going to be sort of only one turn away, basically one, maybe a little bit more than one turn away from the A positions. And so we're going to have, along an alpha helix with this sequence, a stripe of nonpolar amino acids. And let me show you how this works. We're looking down an alpha helix, and we're actually looking down the crystal structure of one of these helices from this sequence. And I'm labeling each of these side chain positions with their heptad position in the sequence. So just zooming in here, we're going to start the sequence at A. And so here is the methionine that's at the A position. Then this is B, and that's a lysine. This is C, that's a glutamine. And this is D, which is a leucine. So the pattern of the alpha helix places the D and the A nonpolar side chains. They're still sort of one turn apart from each other. This is on one turn, this is down one turn as we go through the helix, but they're along the same face of the helix. And then you can continue on from D to E, and then from E to F, and then from F to G. And then we haven't shown the amino acids, but we'd be right back to A again with another nonpolar side chain. And so, and I'm only showing you the first sort of seven amino acids of this sequence. But here is a schematic of what amino acids are at which position in this sequence. This is a helical wheel diagram. It goes from A to B to C to D to E to F to G, and you're turning, as you look at this, as you go around that circle, you're turning down into the page with your helix. Here's the first heptad, A, methionine to lysine to glutamine to leucine to glutamic acid to aspartic acid and to lysine. So that's how you follow the sequence down. But if you do this, one of the things you notice, again, is that you have nonpolar amino acids at D and then at A, with some exceptions. There's a polar amino acid here and another there, but you have one part of the helix that's nonpolar, and then all the other positions tend to be polar. And we can sort of visualize that. Let's fill in with blue all the positions that would be positively charged. So somehow the yellow color isn't doing well with overlaid color. This is blue. You have to imagine that it's blue. So there's a lysine, another lysine. Those are positively charged amino acids. Arginine's positively charged too. Then we'll, in red, label the negatively charged amino acids. Those are glutamic acids. This is aspartic acid. Oh, and I missed another arginine. But you can see that the other heptad positions are highly charged. And in some cases, you have positive and negatively charged amino acids at the same heptad position, but one turn apart from each, or two turns apart from each other. And that can involve, that can sometimes involve interactions between positive and negatively charged amino acids. So the whole idea here is that you've made, when you fold this sequence up into a helix, you have a cylinder that is polar over here and nonpolar over here. Now that doesn't solve the problem of keeping the nonpolar stuff out of water. But it gets us closer, because now you can imagine, what if I took one of these cylinders and another cylinder and brought them together like this, such that the nonpolar surfaces were exposed to solvent, but the nonpolar amino acids are now at the interface between two helices. The nonpolar residues would be here in the middle, the polar residues would be on the surface. And what would that do for folding? That would sequester these amino acids away from water. So here is this actual structure that this sequence forms. Here we see two such helices twisting around each other, and it's the A and the D positions that are at the interface between the two helices where they're sequestered from water. We're viewing over here on the left, we're viewing down the N-terminus of, down the helical axis from the N-terminus of our peptide. And this is what we would see. Zooming in, here is the first A position, it's methionine. And here is the other A position. And so for now, just ignore the other stuff that's down here. These two methionine residues pack against each other in the helix. And then one turn down, you're at a D position, and here you have a leucine side chain. And on the other helix, here's the other leucine side chain, and they're packing against each other. And then another turn down is difficult to see, but we're back to an A position. Here is a valine. And then on the other helix, that's the A position. Okay? So bringing these two helices together pairs A position residues with A position residues. They pack against each other and not with water. And then D position residues pack against each other. And you have this whole stripe of nonpolar residues on this helix packing against a similar stripe of nonpolar residues on this helix. And that is how, if you make a sequence that has nonpolar amino acids with this pattern, likely it is going to form some kind of helix bundle. Okay? I think that's kind of convoluted. I'm sorry. It's been a while since I've explained that. This is an image from, I think, my PhD thesis, which is 2008. Whoa, long time ago. So anyway, questions you want to ask about this? Yeah?
So is it A's and D's that pack against each other, or A's and A's?
A's, that's a great question.
Is there selectivity with which ones pack against each other?
Yes, it depends. You can imagine A's packing against A's, or one helix could shift relative to another, and A's and D's could pack together. And I think there's examples of both of them. Often they're shape complementarity. And so one of the things that you can notice about the dimer is that the A position residues in the dimer tend to be splayed out. Oops, that's not what we wanted. The A position amino acids tend to be pointing outward away from the interface between two helices, whereas the D positions tend to be more pointing directly into the interface between two helices. Here is an A position. Sorry, you can see we're sort of splayed outward versus directly into for the D positions. And there's some shape complementarity that helps. I'm sorry, my A's and D's look a lot alike, don't they? That's really sort of a problem. All right, so you'll find in this sequence that a lot of times the A positions have beta-branched amino acids like valine, because the beta-branch point allows this position that normally is splayed outward to also point back some nonpolar surface area towards the interface between the two helices, and there's plenty of space for that kind of thing. In contrast, at the D position, if you had beta branching in this dimer, the two methyl groups would sterically clash. And so at D positions in this dimer, you tend to have non-beta branched amino acids. They can pack against each other, but there's no room for the branching methyl group. And so that kind of shape complementarity is important and probably why A's pair with A's and D's pair with D's. Other questions? Yeah. How do alpha helices contribute to the function of proteins? It turns out that formation of helices like this is important for viral fusion. So, let's see. If you learn about, what I'm going to draw here is not actually going to be that useful, but here is the HIV. HIV is an envelope virus. It's got a membrane, a lipid bilayer, and in order to infect your cells, HIV needs to fuse its membrane with your membrane and dump its contents into the cell. And the way this works is there's a protein, glycoprotein GP41, on the surface of HIV. What on earth is going on? And there is this protein GP41 has a coil-coil or helix bundle trimer. Sort of like the dimer I showed you before, but only with three helices. And it's got three on this side, and then a flexible linker, and then three on this side. And here is a peptide that inserts into your membrane. And so as HIV viral fusion is occurring, the virus takes this protein GP41 and tethers it to your membrane. And then what happens is these helices have some groups on their surface, grooves on their surface, rather, that the blue helices can pack into. And so what ends up happening is the protein rearranges itself such that the blue helices are here. Packing around the red helices. And what that does is it kinks the HIV membrane and brings it really close to yours. And then they can fuse with each other and the virus dumps its contents in there. So those structures are not anything similar to what I've shown you so far, but I will show you some similar structures in just a little bit. Okay, what else? A lot of viruses have this kind of fusion mechanism. Influenza does. I think the coronaviruses do. Somebody pointed out during the first hour, vesicle fusion in our cells is mediated by a snare complex, and coils are important in that too. All right. So you can actually make some changes to this sequence and cause the helix bundle to adopt some different shapes. So here are some different kinds of structures. By modifying the A and D position residues, you can make the sequence form a trimer or a tetramer, or you can get even pentamers and heptamers. For the pentamers, they're putting in tryptophan, which is a larger amino acid, so it's thought the helices have to be a little bit farther apart to accommodate the tryptophan, and then you can fit more of them around the nonpolar core. But I want to talk actually about the difference between the dimer and the tetramer sequence. So I told you above that in the dimer, we tend to have beta-branched amino acids at A and non-beta-branched amino acids at D, because the A positions can accommodate the beta branch sterically, whereas the D positions cannot. And if we go back to the nonpolar interface for this system, what you see is, yes, we have non-beta branched at D, and then we have beta branched at A. And so somebody had the idea, a research team led by Peter Kim in the 90s had an idea, what if we switched, what if we put beta branched amino acids at D where there'd be a steric clash, and what if we put non-beta branched residues at A? And it turns out doing that caused a switch in oligomerization state from dimer to tetramer. So here's the tetramer sequence. It's a little bit different than the dimer sequence that we looked at above, because here at D we now have beta branched amino acids, whereas at A we have non-beta branched amino acids. And in the tetramer, the A positions, in the tetramer shape, the A positions can accommodate the non-beta branched, whereas the D positions can accommodate the beta branched amino acids. So what are you supposed to do with all of this? Well, and I could show you sort of a similar diagram looking down this helix and seeing that the D positions can now better accommodate the beta branching methyl groups of the isoleucine. But the design principle that people have discovered is, if you want it to be a tetramer, you need beta branches at most of your D positions, and you need non-beta branching at most of your A positions. And that's a simple rule that you can use to control coil-coil association state. So what are you supposed to do with this? Do you memorize it? No, but given data, can you reason your way through this? For example, if I told you about this design principle and then I said, I want to make a dimer, what kinds of nonpolar residues should I have at A versus D? Could you then use that design principle and your knowledge of amino acid structure to design the right sequence? Okay, other questions? Yeah. Are there design principles for trimer, pentamer, and heptamer? Yes, but we haven't talked about them. Well, not in particular. No, I don't think that's worth memorizing unless you're going to go do something like this in the lab. But if given similar information, can you draw conclusions? Yeah. Somebody during the first hour asked, is there a way to control whether two of the same helices interact with each other or whether you can have two different helices? That's a homodimer versus a heterodimer. And the answer is yes, people have done that too. The way they designed a sequence that would be a heterodimer is they put positively charged residues at E and G on one helix and then negatively charged residues at E and G on the other helix. And these E and G positions flank the nonpolar core, and so if you bring two helices together, those E and G positions on opposite helices are going to face each other, and if they're complementary in charge, that works out nicely, and you can specify a heterodimer instead of a homodimer. And then in my lab, we're working a lot with figuring out what to do with the B, C, and F positions, and there's more I could tell you there, but I won't bore you with the details. All right, so that's helix bundles, coil coils, one of the best understood systems. This is one of the first model systems where people really worked out the rules of protein folding. All right, so the other story I want to tell you here is real quick. It's related to antimicrobial host defense peptides. If you've ever been stung by a bee, it hurts. And one of the reason it hurts is because the bee injects, one of the components of the venom that the bee injects into you is called melanin, and it's a peptide that can disrupt membranes. And unfortunately, it can disrupt membranes of your cells just as easily as it disrupts membranes of bacteria, and so it can really hurt. But there are other host defense peptides produced by other organisms that can selectively perforate the membranes of bacteria, but not those of eukaryotic cells. And those are potentially useful as antibiotics. So there's a peptide called meganin, and that's the Hebrew word for shield, but it comes from a frog, a particular species of frog, and it's secreted from frog skin, and it kills bacteria. So I think the antimicrobial host defense peptides are one of the components of like innate immunity instead of adaptive immunity. They're sort of designed as broad spectrum inhibitors of bacterial growth. Here is the amino acid sequence of meganin. You don't need to memorize that sequence. And here is that sequence mapped onto an alpha helix. Now this is a different helical wheel diagram than what we did above, because in a regular alpha helix, that's 3.6 amino acids per turn. So we don't come around to the same spot neatly after seven residues. But this is sort of how the sequence looks if you're looking down from the end terminus. And when this adopts a helix, the nonpolar amino acids in green, you've got isoleucine, phenylalanine, leucine, valine, methionine, all in green. Those tend to be on one face of the helix. So again, as with the coiled coils, you have a nonpolar face. And then you have a polar face, but actually the polar face is mostly positively charged. You see there are lysine residues and histidine, which can be positively charged. And it's this sort of amphipathic or two-faced kind of structure that enables it to interact with membranes. So if you know anything about membranes and lipid bilayers in bacteria, you have negatively charged head groups, phospholipids, right? Whereas in eukaryotic cells, some of the lipid head groups are actually charged but neutral, like phosphatidylcholine. And so a positively charged peptide like this can interact with the, if we envision this peptide as sort of a cylinder with a nonpolar face here and then a positively charged face here, you can imagine that positively charged peptide sort of sitting down on the face of the membrane, interacting with those negatively charged residues. But as soon as that happens, the nonpolar face is in the is close to the nonpolar interior of the protein, of the lipid bilayer. And so actually you can get insertion of this peptide into the membrane. Okay? And if you have enough of that happening, you can generate pores in the membrane. So here is an example of that process happening. This would be our nonpolar face in our meganin peptide. This would be the positively charged face. You can see that the positively charged face is interacting with complementary negatively charged groups on the phospholipid head groups. And then the nonpolar face is interacting with the lipid tails of the interior of the bilayer. And here is sort of what this might look like in a simulation. You have enough of these, and they can actually create holes in the membrane. And one of the great things about a lot of bacteria is they don't have nuclei like you and I. They're DNA is just present floating around in the cytosol, and it's kind of tightly packed in there. And as soon as you lyse the cell, it like vomits out its interior into the outside, and the cell dies. And so this is a great way of killing bacterial cells. The trick is you want a peptide that does this to bacterial membranes, but not to yours. The selectivity in many cases is related to how the balance between positive charge and nonpolar groups that you have on your molecule. It's thought that membrane disruption should be more difficult for bacteria to develop resistance to, because you're dealing with fundamental biophysics there, and all bacteria have membranes like this. So it's thought that if you had a good therapeutic that would disrupt membranes, perhaps it would be useful longer term and result in less resistance when used. People have worked on other molecules that are like this but are not peptides. So Professor Savage has a research project where they've developed a molecule that has a nonpolar face and then a positively charged face. And they're very, very good at killing bacteria. They're now used as topical antibiotics in treating infections. He's also used these types of molecules, his molecules that function like this, as coats for medical devices to prevent colonization by bacteria. So when people get intubated, the endotracheal tube tends to get really nasty really quick. If you've ever seen one or want to see one that's been pulled out of a patient, they're nasty. Go look at that. But don't do it on an empty stomach, I think. And the idea is that if somebody's intubated for a long period of time, they can start to get infections, particularly in the lungs. And so you might say, well, why don't we just pull out the endotracheal tube and put in a new one? And there are many reasons to not do that, but one of them is that in the process of pulling it out and putting one back in, you're actually spreading the bacteria around on the inside. And so it's actually better just to leave it in there, gross as it is. Savage's molecule can coat the inside and the outside of that endotracheal tube, and it can prevent colonization of bacteria for quite a long time. And so there's a lot of work in this area, and they've made a huge amount of progress. But it's related to the idea that if you have an amphipathic molecule that has polar and nonpolar character on different sides, you can disrupt membranes. All right. So now I want to talk about how you might go about making peptides like this, because the ability to do this chemically has really enabled a ton of research. But before we can do that, we're going to need something called protecting groups. You've experienced protecting groups before with silyl ethers like the TBDMS group for alcohols, or acetals, which we use as protecting groups for ketones and aldehydes. But when we want to make a peptide by making an amide bond between two amino acids, there's kind of a problem. You recall that our method for making amide bonds in one of our early chapters this semester was simply to take a carboxylic acid and an amino group, and then we would use DCC, which is a reagent that activates the carboxylic acid and turns it into a good leaving group. Oops. And we need a non-nucleophilic base like triethylamine, and then we make this new amide bond, also called a peptide bond, from the amine and the carboxylic acid. And that worked well, but the challenge now with amino acids is that each molecule that we want to stitch together, something weird is going on, like my pen is wanting to switch randomly to gray. Don't know how that's happening. I wish I could control it. Somebody doing that? I used to lecture with the iPad using an Apple TV so I could sort of walk around the room and still project it up there. But then some intrepid student figured out how to request access to the Apple TV during the lecture. Benjamin wants to access the Apple TV. Permission? No. And the kid did it a couple of times in the same lecture. I was really kind of ticked off at him. Ticking off your OChem professor is generally not the smartest thing you can do, right? Right, so suppose you wanted to make a dipeptide of this glycine residue and alanine. And suppose this is G, this is A. Suppose you just, in an uncontrolled way, use DCC and triethylamine. The challenge is you've got two different carboxylic acids, and you've got two different amino groups. And so the DCC is going to activate either of these carboxylic acids, and then either of those amino groups is going to be a nucleophile. And so you would get the GA dipeptide, but also the AG dipeptide, also the GG dipeptide, and the AA dipeptide. And hey, once you made one of these, here's the one that we wanted, what's to prevent DCC from activating the carboxylic acid on this end and attaching another amino acid? And then you start to get tripeptides and GAA and GAG and so on. And we're gagging now. So funny. And so what we need is a way to prevent one carboxylic acid from being activated and prevent one amino group from being activated, such that we have only one carboxylic acid and one amino acid, one amino group that are available for the reaction. And so we're going to need a protecting group for carboxylic acids and a protecting group for amino groups. Our standards for protecting groups are easy on, easy off, and then if you have two different functional groups that you want to protect, they need to be removed under different conditions. They have to be orthogonal to each other. So protecting group, dang it. Protecting group for carboxylic acids is the benzyl ester. There's a lot of different things you might do, but this happens to be one that's pretty easy. So if you take a carboxylic acid, you use a non-nucleophilic base, and then you use an alkyl halide, benzyl bromide, you can do an SN2 reaction in which the carboxylate, the negatively charged carboxylate, can attack the benzylic carbon and the leaving group leaves, and that creates this ester. And that ester, recall that the mechanism of DCC activation involves removing a proton from the carboxylic acid to make the carboxylate, and then that attacks DCC. And you can review that mechanism in the earlier chapters if you need to. But now that you've protected the carboxylic acid as the benzyl ester, there is no acidic proton. There's no way for this to be nucleophilic. And so it's now inert to DCC. It's not going to react with an amino group. It's inert to DCC. It's also inert to amines. So that's the on reaction, or the protection reaction. The off reaction is important too, because if I want to go on and use that carboxylic acid for something else, I need to have an easy way to remove the benzyl ester. Of course, you could do any ester hydrolysis reaction that you wanted, but one that is easy and actually doesn't touch the other protecting groups is a reaction called hydrogenolysis. And this is if you take your carboxylic acid protected as the benzyl ester, and then you use hydrogen and palladium on carbon, you basically add hydrogen across this carbon-oxygen bond. The reason that works is presumably because you can make toluene as a byproduct. It probably also has to do with the stability of a benzyl radical. We won't learn the mechanism for this reaction, but this works really cleanly. And the only byproduct you have is something that's basically just a solvent that you can remove through extraction or evaporation. Yes? Why doesn't the benzene ring get reduced here? And the answer is aromaticity. It's just too stable to be reactive. Yep. Okay, so protecting group goes on easy, comes off easy. That's how we protect our carboxylic acid. Then we need a protecting group for an amine. Delete it. And our protecting group of choice is going to be called Bach. I'll show you what that is. So here is a reagent. Oops, not correct. This is called Bach anhydride. Bach stands for T-butyl oxycarbonyl. Some people call it T-Bach, but those folks are, again, tryhards. And there isn't any other kind of Bach, so putting the T in there is really pointless. We also abbreviate this as Bach2O because you have Bach here, Bach there, Bach, Bach here, and a Bach, Bach there. Sorry. Terrible. What happens then is you react an amino group with Bach2O, and you need a non-nucleophilic base like triethylamine. The amino group attacks the anhydride, carbonyl carbon, to get a tetrahedral intermediate. You use the non-nucleophilic base to soak up the proton that's on that amine after it attacks. So here is the tetrahedral intermediate that we get. The non-nucleophilic base removes that proton to make the amine stay. Then lone pair electrons on that oxygen can kick down to kick off this leaving group. And what we're left with over here is our now protected amine. Sorry. And then over here the reason why this reaction is irreversible, because now electrons can kick down to make CO2, which bubbles off and you're done. And as a byproduct, you get tert-butoxide, which immediately gets protonated probably by the conjugate acid of our base. And this functional group then is the Bach group, and we will abbreviate that this as the nitrogen with Bach attached to it. This functional group with the carbonyl attached to an oxygen and a nitrogen is called a carbamate. And carbamates are often used as protecting groups. There's a lot of different varieties where you change what's out here, but the general idea is that you want something here that can leave these electrons behind, and then this group can kick off CO2 and leave the amino group unprotected and ready for the next reaction. So that's the on reaction. What does the off reaction look like? The off reaction is really easy. You need a strong acid, and usually that's trifluoroacetic acid in a little bit of water. And that's what that does is the T-butyl cation pops off in an SN1 fashion and gets picked up by water. And at the same time, you get decarboxylation. And then these electrons that were headed toward the nitrogen get protonated by trifluoroacetic acid. And again, you're left with CO2 and now your amino group, which you can now proceed to do the next reaction. This trifluoroacetic acid is abbreviated TFA. Okay, so those groups are going to give us the flexibility to have one carboxylic acid and one amino group react with each other at a time while the others are protected. And then we can go through this systematically to make peptides. So we'll talk more about this next time. We'll probably spend half of next lecture finishing up peptide synthesis. Then we'll move on to the next chapter. So have a good Monday. I will see you Wednesday.